number 260. Hymn number 260. He is able to do the thing.
Trying to recuperate. Linda's just worn out, so she said, pray for her. And then, of course, we had the funeral on Friday for Sister Anique, and her husband brought the flowers today just for us to remember her, her honor. And that went well, and may the Lord continue to bless them and help them get through this hard time in their life. Now, tomorrow, Bible school begins. That poster over there is the grand prize.
All right.
That is a fatty.
I'm winning tomorrow.
Each one of those things on there is a cutout, and it comes off that banner, and it sticks on the wall. So you take that Captain America off there without all that other stuff. Stick it on the wall, in the background of the wall, then he would stand out. Well, I've got a bunch more of that sort of stuff back here that I'm going to put around the building tonight after church. And this is the theme of the week, young heroes. Wonderful young heroes of the Bible. And, you know, wonder had to who has a comic book? Marvelous heroes of the Bible. Marvel comic books. Well, we're going to go marvelous heroes of the Bible. First, we're going to talk about Joseph, and then Esther, and then Daniel and his three friends, and then, of course, that hero of all heroes, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You say, well, is it appropriate to call him a hero? I think it is.
Yeah.
He's my hero, anyway.
Amen.
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 Let's pray together. Father, thank you for those that have gathered here today. May this be a glorious day in thy house. God, give us the strength that we need to preach,
yes,
and the joy and the peace in our heart and the thrill of our soul to sing for you the way we ought to.
Yes.
Bless you as it goes out across the internet today, live streaming. Lord, may many pick up on it and hear the word of God and being blessed by the services of Galilean today.
God.
This we thank you for in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hymn number 229, since I have been redeemed. Starts out saying, I have a song I love to sing. I have a song in my heart I love to sing also.
With tears in his eyes, I could hear
God on it.
Amen.
What makes this singing, that singing, so much different from some others is that you feel God in it.
Amen.
God blesses it. My, that was nice.
Amen.
The beauty of it. I listened to it so carefully. It was so nice. You do a great job when you really want to.
Thank you.
Word.
Yes. Amen.
Down on your knees.
Amen.
Take your Bible, please, and turn to the first chapter of Philippians. Philippians chapter number 1, verse number 1. Read down through here in just a few moments. That's page 1257 in your old Schofield Bible. Use that page a little bit quicker. One of the best things you can do for yourself as a young Christian is to memorize the books of the Bible.
Amen.
Start with Genesis and go all the way through Revelation. If you can memorize the books of the Bible, it'll make it a lot easier to find it when the preacher tells you what to look for. And of course, then you'll find out that some books in the Old Testament, some books are in the New Testament. That might surprise you. But as soon as you find that book read, you let me know. I'll have to cut it out, but that ain't gonna be right. No book of wrecks in the Bible. I have no authority of my own. It's just in this book. Amen.
Amen.
He says, Paul and Timotheus, the servants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus, which are at Philippi, which with the bishops and the deacons. You remember Paul started this church after he'd been in jail. And he got his jailer saved. And some others got saved. A lady named Lydia got saved. So the church started there. And he has great affection for these people. So he's writing back to them after they've sent him an offering to sustain him while he's in prison. And he writes and says, Grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you.
Yes.
Always in every prayer of mine.
Yes.
Every prayer of mine. For you all making requests with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now.
Yes.
Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Even as it is meet or fitting for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel. Ye all are partakers of my grace. For God is my record, how greatly I longed after you all. In the bowels of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment.
Yes, Lord.
That ye may approve things which are excellent, yes. That you may be sincere and without offense till I come till the day of Christ. Verse 11, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and praise of God. Amen. I want to preach to you this morning for a few minutes, I hope just a little while, on God's work in us. He noticed that verse again, if you will, being confident of this very thing. That's verse 6. He that has begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, help me today.
Yes.
I need your touch.
Yes.
I need the freedom of thought, brightness of thought, and speech that Lord, only you can give.
Touch him, Lord.
I pray that you'd override the effects of the medication.
Yes, yes.
And help me, Lord, to speak plainly.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
When we get saved, we literally become a child of God.
Amen.
God calls you his child. You become one of his children, and he will never divorce you. He will never disown you.
Yeah.
You're his child from now on.
Lord.
Verse 6 gives us this assurance that God will continue to work in us the work he began the day you got saved, the very moment of the hour you got saved. Paul said, I'm confident. I'm sure of this very thing. I'm very confident of it.
Come on.
I'm very sure of it. You see, he knew the character and nature of God.
Yes.
He knew that God would not give up on you or me and leave the job half done. Isn't it wonderful to know this morning that God never gives up on one of his children?
Amen.
He always works it through. He's got a plan for them. And I'll get to that in a moment. But God will never give up on your child. You shouldn't give up on your child either.
Amen.
It's God, it says, that does the work in us.
Amen.
It's God. God does this work in us, the work of salvation. He does the work of deliverance when he delivers us from sin and from death.
Yeah.
But notice that when God does this work of salvation in us, it's a good work.
Amen.
He that has begun a good work in you will perform it. God is at work in your life. He's working in my life every day. You may not be so conscious of what he's doing or how he's doing it, but God is at work.
Amen.
Sometimes God is like the guy in the helicopter way up above that you can't see or hear. And he's watching you, and he's seeing the obstacles down the road, and he's guiding you from place to place, keeping you from getting in a mess.
Amen.
How many times did you rush down the house only to have to go back in the house? You ever had this happen to you?
Yeah.
Only to have to go back in the house to get something. When you got in your car, went down the road, before long you saw an accident, and you thought, maybe God kept me out of that accident.
Amen.
See, he sees every turn, every corner. He sees every obstacle in your way. Sometimes he leads you through them, and sometimes he leads you around them. But God is at work in your life every day that you live.
Amen.
Again, the Bible says it's a good work. People want God to make life easy for them. I mean, that would be nice, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
People want God to make life easy, and they literally believe that God must be mad at them if something is not going easy for them.
Yeah.
I mean, the songwriter said, life is easy when you're on the mountain. Well, that's true. When you're on the mountain, the air is fresh.
Yeah.
You're not so choked by the fumes of the filth of the city.
Yeah.
When you're on the mountain, life is easy.
Yeah.
But then you got to go down in the valley once in a while.
Come on.
You don't realize that we're in a very mountainous region, a ridgy, hilly section of the country.
Yeah.
If you come in on Sugarloaf Parkway from 316 out toward Athens, you'll easily see two or three ridge lines as you come across.
Yeah.
I mean, this area we're in is like ridges and valleys, ridges and valleys. Somebody in a day gone by had to cross those ridges and cut through those valleys. Somebody built roads to make it easier for us.
Yeah.
Thank God for that. I thank God for those Christians who have gone before us, who built highways and cut roads, and made it possible for us to have it as easy as we've got it. But God doesn't intend always for you and I to have life easy. Sometimes the work that God does has to be done through difficulty and through heartache and through struggle and through pain. We want him to work on our behalf. We really do. We want him to answer our prayers. But the work that God needs to do in us most of all is that which he does in us and for us on the inside. What he does in us. It's a good work. And it's not done in just... the work is done in us. Now, first we can compare the work of God to many things. We can compare it to a building. He said, ye are God's building. You are God's husband. Now, tell me what a building starts with.
Foundation.
No.
Plan.
Starts with a plan. You can have a foundation. You can't get a foundation until you have a plan.
Right.
I built one house, and I designed my house on the computer. I brought it back to America, showed it to the architect. He drew up the plans. I took my pencil and put in all the light fixtures and light sockets and all that stuff to save myself some money. You know, I'm a cheapskate, really. And we had a plan, and according to that plan, we built that house.
Yeah.
And because we did not deviate from our plan, we built it at budget.
Yeah.
Now, my sisters built a house. And they kept changing it. Drove my brother, who was doing the building, crazy. Why is it we always insist on God doing things our way?
Come on. Yeah.
Okay, God might say to you, okay, I'll do things your way, but it'll cost you more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
It'll take more time.
Come on.
So it starts with a plan. The building of a house starts with a plan. And God has a plan for your life. The painting of a masterpiece is one carefully placed brush stroke at a time.
Come on.
We see these guys get out to paint this flashing on the wall, and they go, woo, 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 woo. They step back and they look at it and say, it's like a turtle going across the creek. one guy looks like a dog, lapping up milk or something. They give it something. They make it. They throw a bunch of paint on the paper on the canvas and try to see something out of it. But the painting of a masterpiece takes time. Over in Wales, I should have brought you the thing I got. Over in Wales, there's a place called Tin Turn Abbey. It used to be a place where the monk was. They said it was Abbey. I called it a monkery, because that's where the monk stayed, in the monk in the abbey. There was a shop there, an artist that sold pictures and paintings. And on his shop wall, he had a painting about half the size of that video projection up there of a bunch of sheep crowded together. All of them were white, but white, right in the middle of it was a black sheep.
All right. Come on.
Yeah. Black sheep right in the middle. Now, that has to do with one sheep that's dishonoring and don't want to cooperate. The black sheep of the family is the bad guy in the family. I said, that looks like my congregation.
Come on.
Over here, he had another picture of three old ram sheep. Painted they just their heads. I said, that looks like my deacons. It wasn't this church I was pastoring, it was one in Wales, so don't get excited about yourself. But the guys, he told us how long it took to paint it. I don't remember exactly how long it was. How long do you remember, Jessica?
2 years.
2 years to paint. And he said it was feet, it was 20,000 pounds. Was it 20,000? I said, well, put it on the credit card. No, I bought a print of it that was about this big. And I hung it on the wall, still on the wall in my guest room at the house. And I look at it once in a while, and it reminds me, I was a black sheep one day.
Yeah.
I surely was.
Yeah.
But God took over. It's like the writing of a symphony, which I've never done. Some bars or some measures, they might come with great inspirations. Others would come with toil and intense thought. I took a glance this morning at Ludwig von Beethoven's Elise. If I said that right. That looks like some of the most complicated music I've ever seen in my life. It is. It's got rest here and rest there, and it just filled with different things, and I couldn't even begin to think about how it goes. But that didn't come to him overnight. I mean, he was a great man, wonderfully inspired, I'm sure, the right thing, but it would come far easier to him than it did to me or to you. But life is like that. Sometimes it's got a song that comes smooth and easy, and sometimes we've got to work and learn our words differently. We've got to work diligently to learn our words. It's like the making of a vessel on a potter's wheel.
Yeah.
He spins it, tries to make it into what he desires it to be, and yet we rebel and it crumbles under his hands, and God has to take us and remold us into something else.
Yeah.
You may have missed your first pathway in life, but God's got another pathway for you.
Yeah. That's right, brother.
Come on, please.
These things and many others can illustrate for us the carefulness that God uses when he works in us.
Yeah.
But please, beloved, realize this. If you resist the work of God in you, then you are going to miss out on letting him make something beautiful out of your life. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. We are his workmanship.
Amen.
I guarantee you, if I was to set up a shop and build you a set of cabinets, and right next door Dale was to set up a shop, he's already got a shop, and to build you a set of cabinets, I could build you a set of cabinets in 2 weeks. I could.
Come on.
I mean, I could cut and throw it together. For all I knew, that's what it was. And it might be good enough to go in your barn. But if Dale made you a kitchen cabinet, it might take him 2 years. I don't know how long it took him to make your sister's I know it was a long time. How long was it then?
Couple
what?
Months.
He did a great job. Yes, he did. That's what I'm getting at. I can make you some cabinets to put your books in or your junk in, but Dale can make you some cabinets to put your precious things in.
Come on.
He can make it look good. I can't do that. And so you can build your own life, do your own business, do your own work, make it whatever you want it to be, but don't complain to God when it comes out looking like a piece of junk. God's work in us is manyfold.
Amen.
I mean, there's several areas in our life in which God has to work, and He's at it all the time.
Yes.
First is the work of redemption, the work of salvation. This is where it all starts. In one sense, the work of redemption is complete the moment you get saved. Just as soon as you get saved, you're going to go to heaven no matter what.
Yeah.
Your redemption is complete in this one sense. But we who are saved then are saved. We are saved forever from eternal death at the very moment we trust Christ. But He continues to work in us. The three tenses of our salvation are easily seen in the Scriptures. First, I have been saved. I am being saved. And I shall be saved. Bible puts it more like this. He says, I've been delivered. I am being delivered, and I shall be delivered. You see, I'm saved from the penalty of sin. I'm being saved right now from the power of sin, and I shall be saved from the very presence of sin.
Amen.
Listen to these verses, and you'll pick up on them. Galatians 3:13. Christ hath. Now, that's an old-fashioned word, but it just means has. Christ hath. It means He's done something in the past. Christ hath redeemed us.
Yeah.
Yep.
From the curse of the law.
Come on.
Titus 2:14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from the curse of the law, and to purify himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. And again, 2 Corinthians 1:10. Who delivered us, past tense, from so great a death, and doth, right now, present time, deliver us, in whom we trust that He will yet deliver us. In the past, He saved me. In the present, He's keeping me saved. In the future, He's going to take me out of here,
yeah,
and my salvation will be made complete.
Yeah.
He's working in your life today to remove that which is wicked and sinful.
Yes, Lord.
So that you and I can truly be saved.
Yeah.
Paul says, all to be at Rome, called to be saints. Wait a minute. He didn't say, to all to be at Rome who are saints. He said, you're called to be saints.
Yeah.
God wants you to be a saint. He didn't say, all of you at Rome who God called a saint. He said, He's called you to be a saint. Anybody here a saint? Well, in one sense you are. We're saints in the sense that we have been saved.
Yeah.
But none of us here are saints in the sense that our salvation or our sanctification is complete. Because I bet there was a day this week you got angry about something. You might have said something you shouldn't have said last week.
Yeah.
You might have been out and driving around Atlanta this week.
Amen.
God is doing the work of sanctification. Now listen, I'm going to slow down just a little bit and get this straight to you, okay? Sanctification, meaning that He is always working to remove the flaws in our character.
Amen.
He's trying to remove the flaws in our character and in our personality. If you are, and I'm sure you are a likable person today. You are easy to like. If you are an easy person to like, as a Christian, you can contribute that, or at least much of it, to the fact that God has been working in you.
Amen.
I won't name any names, but some of y'all are nicer than y'all used to be.
Come on. Amen, preacher. That's right.
I'm nicer than I used to be.
Come on.
God, you see, God is working a work of sanctification in you and I at all times.
Yeah.
He's working to remove the wicked and the sinful things, and the work of sanctification in that work, what he's doing is he's fine-tuning our character.
Yeah.
He's trying to make us truly Christian. God is doing the work of sanctification, but he's also doing the work of education. Education, 2 Peter 3:18. But grow in grace. Grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Growing in grace. What's that mean? Well, people who neglect the reading of the Bible, the teaching and the preaching of God's Word, they become stunted in their spiritual growth. I'm going to say it this way. They become spiritual pygmies. They never get strong. They never grow tall. They never grow to full grace, to full age spiritually. And they just neglect themselves. It's like, you remember when that little girl was kept in the closet and wasn't fed, and she was 7 or 8 years old, she weighed 32 pounds? The daddy or whoever, the man of the family, he, you know, gave a plea, and they gave him life in prison. And the mother, who was responsible mainly for it, said she wants to represent herself in court. Well, that little girl suffered at those people's hands. And she never grew up because she was malnourished. I guarantee you, when you have a person pitching a hissy fit, or a baby crying and pitching a fit, they do it because they're immature. Mm-hmm. Is that not right?
Amen.
Johnny, what you got in your hand? Mama, I want this, mommy, mommy, I want this. No, Johnny, you can't have that. Put it back on the shelf. Put it back now. Johnny, give me that thing. Don't do that. Put that back on the shelf. You can't have that. I know some Christians like that.
Yeah.
I'm going to say something else going to make you mad.
Come on.
I know some husbands like that.
Yeah.
I know some women like that, some wives like that.
You're meddling now.
They thought that the only way they could get their way was to pitch a fit.
All right, come on.
Let me tell you something. What God does is what I did with my daughter. If she pitched a fit in the store, she got one when she got home too.
All right.
Amen.
Come on.
And we never failed to deliver on the promise, and after a while she walked through the store and said, she'd hold it in, buddy. She might not like it, she'd hold it in. And you might not like it, but you better hold it in, man. God's doing the work in your life.
Come on, preach.
Teaching and preaching, that's what makes you grow.
Yeah.
Serving, working for the Lord, exercising your muscle. And at all at the same time, he's doing the companion work of transformation and confirmation.
Yes, Lord.
Romans 12, 1 and 2, I beseech thee. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world. Don't go get tattoos all over your body.
All right.
Boy, I know that's trucking hell somewhere.
Come on.
That's the craziest thing in the world.
Yeah.
Everybody else is doing it. Well, everybody else is going to hell. You're going to fall on there too.
All right. Come on.
Really? You say, well, tattoos send you to hell? No, I'm not inferring that. I'm telling you, that's just confirmation to the world. She's saying, I like what the world's doing.
Yeah.
I like what the world's drinking. I like what the world's eating. I like the way the world's acting. But the Bible says, don't be conformed to the world. If you're God's child, he said, don't you be conformed to the world.
Amen.
He said, would you be transformed by the renewing of your mind?
Yes. Thank you.
He said, why? That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Don't be conformed to the world, but be changed from the world's philosophies and dreams and attitudes about things to God's way of doing things and thinking and seeing things. Listen, what God really wants to do is to change our thinking.
Yeah. Amen.
He wants us to he wants to change our philosophies.
Yeah.
He wants our outlook on life to be his outlook on life. He wants us to see things through his eyes.
Amen.
And verse 29 of Romans 8, he says this. He says, our predetermined future as children of God is to one day be conformed to the image of God's Son. And whom he did foreknow, then he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of God's Son. So quick, go kicking and screaming, but eventually you're going to be like Jesus.
Yes,
if
yes.
You belong to him. Now, last point, I'm done. 12. Oh, it's only 10 minutes, still 12. Is that clock right?
Come on.
Man, we're covering a lot of ground fast. The work that God is doing in us is an ongoing work that he will continue until he comes for us. Perhaps all these things can be placed under the heading of deliverance. I'm glad to know that I'm saved, aren't you?
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
For in redeeming us, he is delivering us not only from death, eternal death, but eternal fire.
Yes.
Like a fire. In sanctifying us, he is delivering us from the power and the presence of sin. By educating us, he is delivering us from the spiritual darkness. In working to transform us and to conform us, he is working to deliver us from ourselves.
Yeah.
You get a hold of that point. He's working to deliver us from ourselves. You think about that. It's not in man that walketh uprightly to direct his path. That's what the Bible says. The Bible says the heart of man is deceitful and desperately wicked. Who can know it? And if he doesn't work in us to deliver us and to conform us to himself, to him, then we're going to be, if we didn't have that predestinated end that we would be like him, we'd never get into heaven. Because we can't be like him, we can't live up there. He'll take it, he's going to make us like him one day. What are you talking about, preacher? We must be delivered from our old sinful self, rebellious and sinful self.
Yes.
Well, getting saved is just the beginning. It's just the beginning of God's great plan. But one has to be saved first.
Amen.
Then
Amen.
God can go to work in us and take that which is ugly and marred by sin and by failure, and make it into a trophy, make us into a trophy of grace.
Yes.
Amen.
Now, Job was born just like you and I, born of his mother. Father gave birth to him. Mother gave birth to him. He grew up in a land in a day where there was no written scriptures. He was before the Bible times, as far as his writings goes, unless he's referred to, he's the Job that's referred to in some of those prophetic letters. But old Job grew up just like you and I do. He had a mom and daddy, he had brothers and sisters. And he developed a character in him that God admired. And when the angels of God or the sons of God were appearing before God to give an account for themselves, and the devil showed up, he said to him, have you considered my servant Job?
Yeah.
Now what was happening was, the devil was probably saying, have you considered my servant rest? The Lord was saying, the devil said, hey, what about rest? I was following him down the street the other day, you should have seen the way he acted. I was listening on his conversation the other day, and you should have seen it. I was looking in on his heart, and you should have seen the corruption I saw there. And he might have been saying, what about you and the gopher? Jim Moore. Brother Phillips. And the Lord said, wait a minute. You got all those, but let me show you Job.
Come on.
Yeah. Have you considered Job? I'm the devil. I don't want to talk about Job.
That's right.
Come on.
Let's don't talk about Job. Because you got him spoiled. You've been protecting him too much. And the turn, and of course, the devil knew that was a lie too. Job had just developed the kind of character that God wanted to see in a man. And that's what he's trying to develop in us. He can work in us, and will work in us, and take the ugliness of our lives, and the marred places, and the failures, and make us something that he himself can be proud of. Do you recognize God's work in you? Do you see what God's doing in your life? Do you? Do you need him to work in your life more?
Yes.
Do you need him to work in your life in some unique and special way? I believe he will if you'll just invite him to do it. Open up your heart and just ask him. Say, Lord, come, please come and do a work in me. That's all you need to do. If you need to be saved, you can say, Lord, come and do a work in my heart. Save my soul. Forgive my sins. Trust me, I trust you as my Savior. I'm depending on you for my salvation. Maybe you need to come and say, Lord, I know you've been trying to work in my life, but I've been fighting you. I've been resisting you. And like the angel or the Lord who, when he appeared to Saul on the Damascus Road, he said to him, he said, hey, buddy, it's hard for you to kick against the bricks, isn't it? What prince was he talking about? Well, I'm not a brilliant scholar, and I don't know the Greek and all that behind it, but I do know this. I think he was talking about the pricks with God every now and then would just prick his conscience.
Yeah.
Now, if I were to prick my finger, what would happen?
Blood
would come out. So every now and then, Paul, after he had heard Stephen preach and saw his testimony, every now and then Paul probably... his mind would go back to that, and he'd hear Stephen say, Lord, don't lay this to their charge. And Paul would say, I was urging them on. I was giving my consent. I was telling them, yeah, go get him, boys. And his conscience would be pricked, and he said, I know I shouldn't have done that. And so as he's marching, going down the road to Damascus to get people and put them in prison, the Lord said, I'm going to stop this business right here and deal with you. I've been pricking your heart, I've been pricking your conscience, I've been talking to you, and you ain't been listening, and it's been awful hard for you to fight and close up your ears and not hear me, isn't it? There's a lot of people that closed up their ears and they fought against God and won't listen to what God's trying to say to them. And it's an awful thing. It's an awful thing. Because God wants to work in your heart. But if you won't let him, he won't. Well, that's enough preaching to satisfy y'all for an hour or two. Would you bow your heads? If I were you, I believe if I were you, God was dealing with my heart right now, I wouldn't wait till the music starts. Just get up out of my seat and come forward. Find me a place in this sacred altar here. Where tears have been shed and lives have been changed and souls have been changed and saved. I just find me a place here around this altar and say, Lord, I need to do business with you today. Will you please come and do business with me? Speak to my heart, let me know what I need to do. Just as I am without one plea, that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee.
Oh,
our church up there so many times, almost every Sunday. It seemed like every Sunday somebody, the altars would be full of people praying for their needs and their lives. You know, we were having revival.